Watching Jackie Chan's filmography, I mused to myself, you know, if it were to turn out that Jackie had let a stuntman fill in for him during one or two of these scenes where you can't see his face, I would personally not be offended. And I honestly wouldn't, as the clear amount of effort that Chan puts into his stunt work while also acting, writing, and directing makes him the clear frontrunner for the hardest working man in ass kicking. So I was not offended to know, going into Chan's 1995 effort Thunderbolt, that he was forced to use stunt doubles for most of the fights in this particular film. After all, he had injured his right ankle in filming Rumble in the Bronx just before this one. It also probably didn't help that Jackie proceeded to film the rest of that movie on his injured ankle, with his cast covered up by a sock colored to look like a shoe. You think that's badass? That's because it is. In addition to that, the film is set in the world of auto racing, meaning that Jackie does most of his action here with a body of metal and steel, as opposed to one of bones and blood. An unusual turn for an action star most associated with man-to-man combat. So, does Chan retain his potency even as he lets his stunt team do most of the work? Well, surprisingly, yes, but the film he's starring in has got a few more problems under its hood. Get it? Because it's a car movie. In Thunderbolt, Jackie plays Fo, a junkyard mechanic and occasional race car driver who prefers working under cars than driving in them. But his docile lifestyle suffers a shock when he decides to help the Hong Kong police force in cracking down on illegal street racers who cruise the streets at night. Eventually, he happens to capture a man by the name of Cougar, played by ponytail Dolph Lundgren clone Thorsten Nickel, who is first seen dragging an undesirable henchman from the tail of his car by the henchman's two thumbs. Now you know what the filmmakers of Garfield did to receive a thumbs up from Roger Ebert. Cougar is initially let go from police custody when Fo is unsure of whether it was Cougar behind the wheel. But after Cougar's thugs rough up Fo and his fellow mechanics at their junkyard, Fo follows the advice of Interpol agent Steve Cannon, played by Michael Wong, and provides a false but incriminating testimony against Cougar. But Cougar doesn't stay caged up for long, as his thugs raid the police station to spring him out, with a police shootout that is surprisingly gory and violent for the standards of a Chan movie. I mean, it seems more in line with a John Woo movie. Hell, even one of Woo's trademark white doves is seen in an earlier chase scene. But for the usually good-natured screen persona of Chan, it feels slightly out of place. Also, it has one of the most unintentionally hilarious NOS that I've seen in a movie in a long time.
No! I just didn't believe you. No! I mean, you gotta sell it. Remember, your no is what gets you your next job. No! Better.
To exact his revenge, Cougar and his thugs arrive at Fo's junkyard in the middle of the night, using a crane to pick up Fo's apartment as he sleeps in it and shake Fo around in that apartment all willy-nilly. He then collides the apartment into their garage, induces Fo's father to have a debilitating heart attack, kidnaps Fo's two sisters, and threatens to kill the sisters unless Fo races against Cougar in a Japanese Grand Prix.
I'll see you in Japan.
Huh. Needless to say, these measures seem a tad excessive. I mean, one could have just kidnapped the sisters, roughed up Fo, and shanghaied him into the race, but I guess that would have been less cool and taken up less of the movie. Hell, even one of Cougar's henchmen comments on this exact same thing.
Hey, Cougar, why not just kill and go?
Don't you think I can use a gun? This is my game. Only a cat knows how to play with a mouse.
Okay, other than your terribly broken English, Mr. Evil McGreaseball, let's examine your logic. By your standards, a cat should burn down the house that the mouse has burrowed a hole into, shake the mouse around in a bucket of nails, and pour lemon juice over his freshly wounded body, while having his way with the mouse's wife and making sure the mouse watches every moment, right before you just shove the fucker into your mouth. Genius. But another problem I have with this pivotal moment is that it is so goddamn long. We see Fo and his family get tossed around and scratched up by Cougar and his thugs in excruciatingly slow motion, with this dramatic music that seems more fitting to the burning of a Vietnamese village than a goofy villain making his standard threats to a protagonist. Abba! 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 I mean, it treats the injuries to Foe's family as if they've been done to characters that you've fallen in love with and hate to see being savagely beaten, when they're just actually being done to characters that are only there to get hurt slash kidnapped so the hero can come out of his docile existence and go into Rambo mode. The film during the sequence also starts deleting frames left and right, and takes on this choppy appearance that may have been cool in 1995 when we started adding that function to our VCR cameras, but it ends up hopelessly dated now, and real irritating. On the other hand, this gets some quite good dramatic moments out of Chan, as he confronts Agent Cannon about his failure to protect his family.
What are you doing?
So as Foe revs up for the big race, he reluctantly gains a love interest in Amy Yip, played by Anita Yuen, a pesky news reporter who is secretly filming Foe's exploits for the sake of a big scoop. Yuen's character can sometimes end up more on the Willie Scott side than the Marion Ravenwood side on the scale of supporting love interest, especially when her exploits to win Foe's heart nearly trip Foe up in the big race scene. Oh yeah, good job, honey. I mean, he's out there literally taking part in the race of his life. But no matter, this is totally the time to declare your love and distract him with your frickin' sign. Screw the sisters, they deserve to die, and let's hope they burn in hell! But on the whole, she ends up being tolerable. Taking the fight scenes for what they are outside of the fact that they are mostly stunt doubled, they end up being pretty good, and the one taking place in a pachinko parlor is a real highlight. But if you're one of those guys who likes to play spot the stunt double, it may be less enjoyable for you.
I'm going to identify when it's Shatner and when it's his stunt double, Fred Lubins. Let's watch. That's Shatner, of course. That's Lubins. That's Shatner. That's Lubins. That's Shatner. That's Lubins. That's Shatner. But when I freeze frame, you can clearly see Lubins' coffee cup sitting on that rock.
Besides, there are really only two real fight scenes in the film, as most of the film's action sequences are on the race course. But those sequences are fairly good as well. Well, aside from the speeding up of the footage for dramatic effect, that reminds you of a Benny Hill skit at times. Auto-mechanical carnage! Though the action is not up to Chan's high standards for obvious behind-the-scenes reasons, it works within the context of the film's delightfully cheeseball tone, with the reluctant fighter forced to fight after his challenger harms slash kills a family member slash friend. It feels more like a Rocky sequel than anything, just on wheels instead of in gloves. But it works in the film's favor, and you end up rooting for Foe to cross that finish line in spite of yourself. Well, admittedly, you do wish that with all the shit Cougar heaped on Foe this entire movie, that they would have participated in an extreme hand-to-hand bout, as opposed to just rubbing each other's rear ends. I was referring to racing there, you sick bastards. Racing! Well, that really did sound wrong upon further reflection. Anyway, the film is a bit too restrictive for Chan to play to his strengths, as he portrays a serious-minded character who cracks relatively few jokes and busts relatively few heads, and the few heads he does bust are mostly done by fairly obvious stunt doubles. But looking at it in the vein of an overwrought 80s actioner type of movie, it's fairly enjoyable, if egregiously overlong at 110 minutes. If you're willing to forgive Chan for sitting out the brunt of the stunt work on this one, and take it for what it is, you should have a fairly good time. 3 out of 5.
I'm a bomb!
Okay. Oh my god, help me! I don't want to die! Oh, stop, drop, and roll!
I'm a bomb!
Help me, Jesus! Help me, Jewish God! Help me, Allah! Ah! Help me, Tom Cruise! Tom Cruise, use your witchcraft on me to get the fire off me!